everybody, and welcome back to Indie Chat. I'm your host, Chance Berberick, and I'm here with guests Andrew and Jake Hunsicker. How are you guys doing today?
Good. Great.
Yeah.
Great glad to be here. Thanks for having us.
Yeah. Glad to have you on the show. So you guys have been busy, I've been seeing. You allowed me to actually check out what you're working on, and it looks pretty cool, but we'll get into that till a little later. So what I'd like to really start out with is let the audience kind of get to know your story and what got you into filmmaking. So I'll start with you, Andrew. So what got you into filmmaking?
I always loved films. I always wanted to act when I was growing up. I'm 57.
Uh-huh.
Now, when I was growing up, I loved films. My father would take me to films. Wow. In the 70s, and that was the year I grew up, and it just fascinated me. So I wanted to act, and I went to college though, and then one year, about sophomore year of college, I applied for the a scholarship or summer program at the American Academy of Dramatic Arts in New York, and I got in. It was a summer program. It was summer, not New York. But I was like, I couldn't believe I got in. I went up and auditioned, did the whole thing. But then, it was like, this is 83. But I started telling myself, I couldn't afford to live up in New York. And I don't know where to live. This is before the internet. So you had to like get a brochure and understand, I didn't know anybody up there. I was looking at YMCAs to stay at. And I just thought, I chickened out.
Basically. Oh, okay.
I'm doing. So I got married, had kids, including this one and three others.
Yeah.
And I was always really kind of, had that itch I didn't scratch. So when these guys were pretty young, all four of them under 10, like 99 or so, I decided I was going to write a script, or a year 2000, actually. And I just decided I can't act anymore. I'm too old, but I'm going to write a script. And my wife gave me an idea, said, it's fascinating when people who sell their soul to the devil have to give it up.
Yeah.
And I was like, that sounds pretty cool, like a way to build a script around that. So I took that idea and I built this script called The Arrangement. But I still wanted to act, but I tried to sell the film. Couldn't do it. Got a couple options, put it on the shelf. Went on with my life for about 10 years. And then I finally got the courage to start to act. Mm-hmm. And I went out and went back to classes and got some encouragement. And at my age, at 50, there's a need for older guys, So great, I got a lot of opportunity to do it. So that got me on this path of acting, which I truly love. And I've been doing it since 2013.
Very cool. Took the effort and took the big leap and got into it, because you're a heck of an actor, and you were in my film. So glad you were there to
I love working with you, thank you for that. It's a joy. It's a joy to do. And if you're doing this sort of thing, you got to love it, because it's a grind. It's a grind.
Yeah, it definitely is. Sure. All right, Jake. So what about you?
Well, what got me into filmmaking? Well, I've always enjoyed films, even when I was younger, particularly horror films. That's kind of like, it was like my first love, I think, like Friday the 13th, Halloween particularly.
Okay.
So I think that's kind of where I got, like, my interest for film really kind of sparked. I even actually made like an homage to Halloween when I was like 7 or 8. Like I shot a film.
Wow.
Yeah, my family. It was, don't tell anybody, but yeah, that happened.
And, there's one copy.
Yeah. As I got older, my father and other people introduced me to some really kind of, cool different films, different filmmakers, like Sidney Lumet, Martin Scorsese, Quentin Tarantino. And that's kind of, my interest in it kind of grew from there. And I was always, always enjoyed writing. And I got to a certain point where my father had started acting, and, we'd met people in Philly, different filmmakers, and we I'd written a short film and we decided to shoot it, and from there on out I kind of just was learning on set more, going to sets with him.
Yeah,
that's kind of where my background kind of came.
Gotcha.
And honestly, just watching films growing up is really kind of what got me into it, honestly.
Yeah, it's kind of the same thing for me there, just wanting to be a part of it. It was like this magic, I got to be a part of it.
Storytelling,
it is magic. I mean, Jake's being he's being quite he's not bragging, let's put it that
right way. Yeah.
Jake knows so much about film. He's really kind of almost a, no one's saying encyclopedic, but he has a great background of film, not just scenes or actors, but I'm talking cinematographers, directors, obviously, and it's actually is pretty cool, because I could say, you know, in 2002, who was the who was nominated for best cinematography? It's like boom, 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 you know. And that kind of, it's just, it helps me to go back and look at a lot of the films that I may not have seen. And
take it off right.
I hear Jake's looking at them, so I go back and educate myself a little bit.
Yeah. But it looks like all of your family is kind of involved in it. I just recently saw your new movie. I see the poster behind you guys there, The Arrangement.
Yes, sir. Yep.
And then it's like the Aussie, all the Hunsickers in there. I was like, there's that. I was like, okay.
Well, you know, your brother actually executive produces some of your
Oh, films. He does. Yeah, right. Yeah, he does. Yeah.
So indie films are a family affair.
Yeah.
I mean, filmmaking's a family affair. It's like a family business. All of them are involved. Jake is the major contributor. My daughter Melissa helped produce the arrangement, acted in it, helped with the pros. Nick, my son, younger son, he's a great actor, great theater guy too. Yeah. Does a lot of musical theater, but he was involved and also helped us on set, art direction, things like that. And my oldest daughter Jessica is not even living here in Philadelphia, where we are near Philadelphia, she's out in Pittsburgh. She contributed some artwork to the show. And as I said before, my mother's an executive producer in her honor. But my wife came up with the idea. My wife greenlit the film. You know, she's the boss. it's across the whole family.
Yeah,
you know, it's great. It's great because then you work with people who you love and you do what you love. But also, before I get off the families,
our
film family too. We got, you know, Danny Donnelly and Jennifer Kay and Amy Teresa, people who are in the film, but we've done work with them in the past.
Brian Keenan,
who's Dave Capper. These guys and girls, we've worked with them several times in the past, and it's just it's a film family. It's a true family because we do what we love to do.
Yeah. I see you brought in a big name actor as well, right there. That's the big kind of like, I was like, whoa, okay, all right. I haven't been able to get to that role. You got Eric Roberts to actually star in that movie.
Yeah, it was a wonderful experience.
Yeah.
What was it like directing it?
It was, it was honestly just, it was a blast. It was, you didn't have to, he's just such a machine. The guy just moves, you know? It was just kind of like just, making sure you got everything he was doing, giving like minor adjustments because he was already on fire, and it was really just letting him get to do it, man, and like just letting it go because it was just you're sitting there, Eric Roberts is, you know, acting in front of you, and you're like, oh my god, like
you're right.
Yeah. I just tried to be starstruck. No, it was just he was, you know, just a he was wonderful to work with. Yeah. I couldn't have asked for more with him. He was awesome.
Right.
Yeah, a machine, really.
Really.
and you're right. And you know what's great about you go with the flow, man. This guy's producing. Why try to minor adjustments?
You don't want to, you don't want to micromanage a guy like that because he's just full steam ahead. You know, like you just make sure he's on the right course, but you don't want to mess. I mean, but really, in terms of like him being a machine, I mean, the guy didn't take breaks, man. I swear, like hit the bathroom like once every like 5 hours or
he wanted to collaborate. He was always looking for input, like, this was that right, was that the right way? But we have so much, you know, and James, you know, you get so much footage, right?
Yeah,
I've popped on his takes and just watched them as an actor. I'm like wow. I mean, it's a lesson for me just how each one had. It was the same but different. It was it gave you something different every time. A lot of times going in the moment.
Yeah.
Just truly a machine and easy to work. Like you said, easy.
It's like a light switch. Like, just like
it really was. Like it was. And also just the nicest guy. We had about maybe 40 or 50 people. We had a lot of people on set that day. We went. Our sets were two or three. Well, four crew maybe. You know, four or five crew. But counted me because I was on the crew. But I was.
Right.
The weakest link on the crew, and then, you know, however many actors we had, so we always had less than 10. That day we had a lot because we had a lot of background folks, a lot more help on crew. But he I don't think he turned down a selfie. I don't think he turned down talking to anybody. I don't think he ever. It was almost like dragging him away from people. He's such an engaged guy, and it was a joy, and he kills.
Speaking of that, there was a point in the film, probably the second day. we were in between takes and we were trying to get ready to go again. And I'm like, where's Eric? Eric, where are you? And like, we were shooting, it was an audience or like seats for an audience. And there's people, you know, watching. I'm looking for Eric and we look over and he's like leaned over like three seats, like two rows,
yeah,
you know, three seats, just talking to some viewers, you know, like,
we need you.
Yeah, like, yeah, I'm like, Eric, we're gonna shoot, man. He comes running back over.
He's like, oh, yeah, boss.
Yeah,
he's
it was awesome.
And we also had besides Eric, a lot of great actors in the Philadelphia region.
Definitely did, yeah.
And we also had a Deborah Twist from New York, a great actor, does a lot of like Blue Bloods and things like that. Network TV.
Yeah.
And Brittany Amber, a fantastic actor from Los Angeles. She was a godsend too. She just came in, total pro, came in, nailed it. Really good experience with those kind of guys. But there is, you know, when you bring in people from out of town, a little trepidation, I guess, but it worked out fantastic.
Yeah.
It couldn't work out.
Really, it couldn't really.
Because we're worried, you know, coming in, we're like, you know, the flight's delayed, this, that. And, you know, indie films, you got to shoot when you have the location.
Right, you got to go. Yeah.
It was really went well. I mean, I look back at that, it was a lot of work from everybody, and so many people helped out.
Yeah.
But it really did go very well, and we were very pleased.
Okay. Yeah, well, it just shows to your guys' talent to be them to read your work and your script and like, yeah, I want to be a part of this too. You guys, it was an amazing story. It had a lot of things going on there, and you wrote really different characters. They didn't seem the same. They were all very unique characters, which is hard to do at times, but you guys, every one of them was a very unique individual. So that comes off of your direction as well as being able to make them so unique and how they acted and everything.
I talk about the actors, right?
Yeah,
everyone was incredible. Danny Donnelly jumped right into Harry Frick because, you know, as you know, my father, he wrote the script years and years ago, and I kind of grew up with it. I read it for the first time when I was probably 12.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept reading it growing up. I knew this story, and then I was you know, elated that he would let me kind of help him.
Right.
Just kind of like smooth it over before we took it to the screen, you know? But
he's being modest. So the script was written, the story was there, the spine.
Right.
And James, you know this, when you either want to move the story along, you know, develop character or get a laugh, right? Every line has to do something.
Right. Yeah, push the story
and that's
forward.
That's somebody told me that.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So I think the script, as I fashioned it, was really pushing the story forward.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't take care of the character development as much. It had some, but it was enough. And just the punch of the dialogue. And that's where Jake, it just helped to go back over everything and go, yeah, can we make that funnier? Is the character more, how can we tie it? And it didn't add, it actually ended up being a couple pages less. We went through it because we cut some scenes that were this long down to here. We kind of got to cut to the chase. Mm-hmm. So on some scenes and other ones we enhanced, but you talk about the characters, that's a lot of him because he worked with these actors like, you know, not just Danny and Jen, but like Mike McFadden, Brian Wilson. Have you ever watched The Wire? Brian Wilson. He's like an icon around here. We have Melissa O'Donnell and all these fantastic actors in the area. Allison, KJ Lindheim. I mean, we had probably about 40 speaking roles, and about 20 of them are substantial, like character parts. Every part's a character part, but and so thank you for that. That's really cool to hear.
Yeah,
that's all the direction and the actors getting that together.
Yeah. So, all right. So I'm at the point of we're at the point of the show where I'm going to ask you the three top three here. So I'll start with you, Andrew. Who are your three favorite actors or actresses?
Nick Nolte is one of my favorite actors. I always love him. Kathy Bates.
She's
love
fantastic.
What she does.
Yeah.
And it's a hard question, but I'm going to go weird. Third, I'm going to go to a guy named M. Emmett Walsh.
Oh, okay.
He was in, What was it called? The Acone Brothers one.
Blood Simple.
Blood Simple. That's where I first saw him. And anytime you need somebody who's just mangy mutt, like the sleazy guy, this guy comes in. I love that kind of character actor. So
yeah.
Favorite actors. Movies, did you say?
Oh, well, no, I'll stick with that. I'm going to go to Jake here first. You can either your three favorite actors or actresses, or you can even go into directors as well.
I guess I'll go to directors since you know, the actors there. I got to go Paul Thomas Anderson. He's probably my favorite of all time. Yeah. Everything he does, I love. I just, just
fantastic. Yeah.
Realism, you know?
Yeah.
I got to go Quentin Tarantino just because of the change. Storytelling forever with Pulp Fiction and everything. Right. Again, I feel compelled to just go and watch anything he does because he's amazing.
True.
it's tough. Right now, I think I might go, honestly. I think Alejandro Gonzalez Iñárritu of Birdman and The Revenant. His style kind of really influenced me a lot. Like Birdman, I saw that film like 4 times in theaters.
And,
yeah.
And kind of changed the way I looked at filmmaking. So.
Right. Yeah. Fantastic. All right. I'll go back to you, Andrew, with your three favorite movies or three top movies there.
Oh, gosh. So, I'm going to go 70s. I got to say Godfather. And that's kind of a cop out, but it's not. It's just a good family movie. A lot of drama. Uh-huh. You know, it really is. It's a good family movie with fantastic actors.
Uh-huh.
You know, what I watched recently and I love, and it really leapt back up, there was Network. It's a Sidney Lumet film, 76. Patty Chayefsky, I think, wrote the script. And that was just, it's as relevant today as it was back then. And that's probably another feature, too. If something I can watch then and still watch for 20, 30, 40 years later.
Right.
And dig it. It's a pretty good film. God, man, another film. I'll say 12 Angry Men.
Because
the original one with Lumet. I read his book, and talk about a good book to read, James. You didn't read it? Making Movies.
Yeah.
His book called Making Movies. And he talks about how he just changes the, you know, changes the lens width and the depth of the lens as he film. And he saw how a director could help influence a film more. It really educated me. So
All right.
The film itself was so intense when I saw it, and then I saw why he did it, and I was like, this is something else. So yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
All right, Jake, what about you?
It's tough. It changes constantly, but if I had to pick three right now, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest has got to be up there. It still is probably one of the only films that like can still make me cry. I'll have to go up to mention Birdman again.
He took a lot of chances there too.
And I think I guess Pulp Fiction.
I feel like I got that's wrong. Answer wrong.
Always classic. All right. So Andrew, what are three things you would recommend to upcoming filmmakers about getting into the business?
Anything you do, get on set. I mean, doing it is better. I mean, I'm not learn.
Right.
But get on set, shoot. You can shoot with an iPhone, man. You can shoot, and you really can. So do it.
Yeah.
And when I started acting, I took a lot of things. I wanted to do as many different projects as I could, and I learned so much. So number one, do it. Number two, be patient, man, and stay with your heart. I mean,
Believe
in yourself. It's not a money game. It's hard, you know, but you have to love it. And if you love it, there's no better day than a day on set, right? So be patient and I think about have a plan, I guess, in terms of when you go to do a project, know what you want. That's not means you can't deviate. In fact, it allows you to deviate more. If you've got a plan, then you can really go off base and you can go capture things and then see how it works. So,
All right.
I guess.
And if I had to pick three, I guess, for like filmmakers, just I guess maybe trying to improve or like grow. I think one, just watch films, different films. It's always sounds cliche, but really, I mean, like there's so many times where I'll see a different film and it changes kind of it affects something I do down the line, because it was a scene in that film that really made me rethink things.
Mm-hmm.
Two, I think, would be just honestly kind of engage in different forms of art, no matter what, like, you know, like writing poetry,
mm-hmm.
or like drawing, or like writing different stories. I mean, any sort of, any creative outlet, I think, is good for filmmakers in any regard. Mm. And then three, I think, just never be afraid to collaborate. Keep true to your artistic, keep true to your artistic, you know, ambitions and what you want to do, your goal, but really don't be so limited on that path there that you eliminate good ideas around you from other good collaborators.
Yeah.
It happens sometimes, and it's a shame.
Yeah.
Everybody's got a voice. If you're working with talented people, don't shut them out.
Right. No, definitely not. Yeah. That was kind of like my thing earlier, and I was kind of like shy about collaborating, but now that I've gotten into it and I kind of like getting into mastering a little bit of my craft, I'm like, okay, all right, now I want to start collaborating because I feel comfortable enough. And that's when things start to really happen, is you're reaching out to other people and it just starts. Yeah. That's what the big thing is. So
You feed off each other.
Right.
It has so many different talents, even though they might share your talents in some ways.
Yeah.
They're different levels. Collaboration and go to the film, the arrangement.
Yeah.
That was a collaborative family environment. I hope it was. I hope it felt beautiful that way, because I think they all dove in to work. I never seen people work harder than on a film set. Being open and flexible and being ready to take on any challenges.
And I hope, and I think everyone felt this way, but I hope that everybody felt like their voice was heard, because we had so many great, wonderful artists and actors and fellow filmmakers on set. Everybody, right? You know, everyone. I think they felt that way, though.
Yeah. I definitely would say it was a great movie, and it felt like it was a very cohesive, everybody did their best and turned out a really good film. So what's the next step for this movie? Is it going to kind of have a release of some kind, or is it going to go?
It's out now on demand. So
it is on demand.
It's on demand. So in fact, if you have one of those things you can talk into, which I'm old school, you can just talk to the arrangement, say 2020, because there's a film in 69. Ken's movie, with Kirk Douglas. That's, you might pop that, but
able to buy a DVD on Amazon,
Blu-ray DVD on Amazon.
Oh, it's on Amazon. Okay, check it out.
Blu-ray. And there'll be other platforms coming. It's being released, or it's been released by our distributor, Gravitas Ventures.
Oh, okay, good.
And they roll it out as they roll it out. You know, they'll tell me when other platforms. You know what they're doing.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good that you guys had a distribution and everything. Yeah, I'm glad to see that it's just rolling out everywhere. So it's a really great film, everybody. So if you're out there watching this, definitely go check it out. Definitely a great film. Watch it anywhere you can.
Yes.
Let everybody know. All right, this is coming to the close, guys. So glad to have you on the show, and let everybody know where they can go check out your film and check you guys out.
So the arrangement movie, on Facebook, The Arrangement Movie.
Mm-hmm.
On Instagram, it's @TheArrangementMovie, one word. And on Twitter, it's @TheArrangement4, the number 4 on Twitter.
Right.
Me, Andrew Huntsker on Facebook, and all those guys.
Same. Jake for Facebook,
All right. Glad to have you guys on the show. All right. Thanks for having you.
James, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Great.
Bye.